Welcome to Sports Close Up, Mike Firo, Jim Berger. Jim, welcome for your first studio production.
This is quite a setup we have here.
Let's talk about our show here with Bill Hillgrove just a little bit. Great interview, wasn't it?
Oh, it was incredible. It was one of those times where, you know, we had 45 minutes. We could have probably been there for 4 or 5 hours. He was incredible to talk to. Unassuming, you know, the nicest guy ever.
Very nice guy, and let's get right to it. Here's our interview with Bill Hillgrove, the voice of the Steelers and the Pitt Panthers. Welcome to Sports Close-Up, Mike Firrell, Jim Berger. Special guest today for this show, Pitt broadcast for over 40 years, Steeler broadcast for over 20, the great Mr. Bill Hillgrove. Bill, thanks for coming on.
Hey, good to have you guys here.
And we're at Bill's summer place here at Conneaut Lake. And Bill, first question, I want to go back in time. Tell the viewers where you were raised and what sports you participated in when you were a youngster.
I was raised in the Garfield section of Pittsburgh. I'm a city kid. Went to Central Catholic and then Duquesne University, and knock on wood, I haven't had to leave. And I remember as a young person saying, you know, I wanted to be a Major League Baseball player, found out I wasn't the best player in my neighborhood, let alone good enough to make a roster. But I also at a young age discovered that I had a flair for being on this side of the microphone. And I was finally able to combine the two, passion for sports and the ability to not trip over your tongue when you're talking about sports people and sports games and, you know, all of the above. I wasn't a very good athlete. I was probably a better baseball player than anything because my house was almost next to Fort Pitt Field in the city. Mm-hmm. And from that field, you could see the light standards at Forbes Field.
Ah.
And I remember saying as a little kid, I'd like to be part of that someday. Well, in a roundabout way, I was able to do it, and I've been very fortunate.
So you've been a Pittsburgh fan your whole life, Steelers, Pirates, etc.
And I'm involved with teams that I grew up rooting for. Now, at Duquesne University as a student, I didn't necessarily root for Pitt basketball, but it all has worked out very well, and my children became Pitt people and were raised basically in the old field house and at Pitt Stadium, so, you know, it's been a very fortunate thing. I have a love affair for sports, Pittsburgh sports teams, and certainly the fans.
And you majored in journalism, as I see. When you were younger, did you like make believe you were a broadcaster when you watched the game or around your house or so?
My dad was an electrician, and he set up a wireless microphone that worked through the radio. Oh. And so the kids would play in my backyard, and I was up in the bedroom window at a young age calling the games and pretending that I was Bill Stern or Ray Scott or one of the broadcasters of the day. And he had a sign painted, WHIL. It was on my bedroom door, you know, quiet please, that type thing. And so from a young age, I kind of got a feel for the business, and I've had a passion for it. And combining that with my passion for sports, it's been a dream.
Did you start broadcasting at Duquesne events, or you know, when did you branch out into the Pitt area?
And that's advice I give to young people who are thinking about doing it. The only way to learn how to do it is to do it. And at Duquesne at the time, the student station, WDUQ, had 91.5 on the dial, back before anybody had FM radio. but I had a chance to do stuff. I had a chance to prepare newscasts. I had a chance to be a disc jockey. Hosted an opera show, you know, did everything and stayed as versatile as I could. And I remember some advice from a veteran broadcaster who'd said, you know, if you want to get a job, you got to get the foot in the door. And the way to do that is to be able to say, yeah, I've done that. Whether it's sweep the floor or, you know, polish up the glass in the studio or, you know, do on-air stuff. And when the boss came to me in 1969, the program director at TAE Radio, he said, we're in the process of getting the games away from another station mm-hmm. for the University of Pittsburgh. Ed Conway, who was at the time the main anchor on Channel 4, was going to do the football. And they said, but he can't travel to do basketball. We want you to do basketball. But have you done it? And I said, yes, truthfully, because as a student at Duquesne, I did a lot of Duquesne basketball. And they had a wire connected to South Stadium across the river. And I did some high school football. So I honestly could say yes. And so for young people, you know, do it. They're not going to ask necessarily what your grades were or, you know, how much education you have or how many degrees. they're going to ask you, have you done it? Mm-hmm. And that's how you get your foot in the door.
So when you first started doing Pitt basketball, you're doing it at the Pitt Fieldhouse back then, obviously. Who was your first partner, do you remember?
Well, Dean Billick was the SID, and he traveled, so he was available. But at one point in time, Tim Gergerich, who was an assistant under Buzz Riddle and then later the head coach, heard Dean be critical of players. And Dean was a very good journalist, and he felt that he wasn't going to wave the blue and gold flag, that he was going to call it like it is. Well, sometimes parents of players get a little uptight when you criticize their young people. So it was a tough situation. And I remember having been at Dick Grote's golf course that he was very interested in basketball. If you talk to Dick, he loves basketball. He had to work at baseball, but basketball came naturally to him. So the idea was to get Grote involved, and boy, he snapped it up. And would you believe we're going to be together 37 years? We're the most tenured duo in college basketball.
Wow. I know, and as you said, you know, people know him as a great baseball player for the Pirates and the Cardinals, and he beat the Yankees twice in two World Series. He's noted for that also. But yeah, you guys have a great harmony together when you do the game. Did that come natural, or has it just gotten better and better?
Yeah, it's gotten better and better. But Dick has taught me so much about the game. First of all, he calls the defense for me. And he can even call a triangle and two. Not that we see it that often. But, you know, he's good that way. He gives me nonverbal communication. We're in a zone or man-to-man, a 1-3-3, you know, he tells me nonverbally that we're in a certain, and I think that's important. I think the fans sure. want to know what defense we're facing mm-hmm. or what we're playing.
Right.
And the guy has taught me a lot about the game. I remember having talked to Red Auerbach, who was Dick's wow. freshman coach at Duke.
Wow.
And Red said, Dick stuck with the wrong sport. He said, the big ball is where he could really excel. He said the little ball he had to work on, and he's right. Worked at it pretty well.
Yeah, he did work at it pretty
well.
You know,
batting
well.
Title, yeah. MVP, a yeah. couple of wins over the Yankees in seven games, but it broke his heart when Mr. Rickey said you can't do both. He wanted to play for the Fort Wayne Pistons.
Huh.
He only could play one season.
Wow. So has the equipment evolved and gotten better as your broadcasts, you know, over the years, and difference between broadcasting basketball at the Pitt Fieldhouse and where you are now at the beautiful center?
Yeah, it certainly has. And now, when we're on the road, they use ISDN. And the next step, and it's imminent, I think the whole ACC in like 2 years is going to be on the internet, you know, an internet version of mm-hmm. The high-tech quality sound. It's easier on your ears. It's easier on your voice when you can hear yourself and you don't have to try to yell over crowds. So, yes, the equipment has gotten a lot better. And, you know, I think the fans become accustomed to it.
Also, talking about the move from the Fieldhouse to the Pete, football-wise, you know, I grew up watching Pitt in the big stadium. What was it like, you know, moving from the stadium back down to Heinz Field?
Yeah, it was a transition. It was tougher. And there are doubters who say that because it's not on campus that Pitt can't fill the stadium. But I'll give you one example. When Pitt played Cincinnati for the Big East Football Championship on a December Saturday afternoon a few years back,
yep.
And lost a really tough game. I mean, they had a chance to right. really blow the Bearcats that. Out.
Yep.
And then, what was his name, Marty Gilliard returned a kickoff or a punt for a touchdown, yep. and things changed. But that was a full house. If you win, people will come. Mm-hmm. And so I mm-hmm. think if Pat Narduzzi wins like I think he will, I think they'll fill that stadium.
All right, so you're doing Pitt football, and in the fall you're doing Steeler football, you're doing both. How tough is that? Like if Pitt has a home game and the Steelers are on the road somewhere.
You know, I think Mr. Rooney and my father, who both passed away in 1988, I think they're up there working on the travel schedule. The Steelers are playing the West this year.
Right.
And fortunately, I don't have a severe conflict with any of the West Coast games. The only conflict I have is Pitt at Syracuse mm-hmm. on a Saturday and then at Kansas City on a Sunday. And the tough part about that is that Kansas City will kick it off 12 o'clock local time.
Right.
And so that's a little bit of a squeeze, but the priority is Steelers, and then Pitt football, and then, of course, Pitt basketball. So I've missed some basketball games. I've missed a couple of football games for Pitt. I was in London with the Steelers when they played Virginia. I had to miss that one. Last year, what was the conflict? I had to miss a game. I was in Maui, and I had to miss the Syracuse game. That was not bad duty.
Tell us the most memorable football game you announced for the Panthers over the years, a game that comes to mind right away.
1976, Pitt at Navy. Matt Kavanaugh's on the shelf. Tommy Usick's the quarterback, pitches it to Dorsett. I called him Dorsett in those days. A lot of people still do. And he ran 33 yards for a big touchdown that broke Archie Griffin's NCAA rushing record. The Navy fired the cannon. They never fire that cannon for anybody but the Navy.
Right.
But they fired that cannon to observe that historic moment. The whole brigade of midshipmen doffed their caps, which started me to become emotional.
Sure.
And I'm saying, oh, I can't talk. What, Johnny Sauer, please bail me out. And I turned and looked at him, and he's got tears going down.
Wow.
You know, you realize that that's a once-in-a-lifetime athlete.
Sure.
And that was the most impressive thing. Tony's parents got out of the stands and walked around the perimeter of the stadium, and people recognized them, too. So that was a great moment. For the Steelers, I think it's pretty easy. I think Super Bowl 43 in Tampa, when Larry Fitzgerald scored the touchdown, and things looked dark, and with a 2 minute and change in his pocket and a holding call to overcome, Ben took him right down the field, put a pass on hands every time, Steeler hands.
Right.
Santonio should have caught the one in the left side of the end zone. He did catch the one on the right side of the end zone.
Which was a tougher catch.
It really was. And, you know, I'm away from it. I'm on the other side of the field, and it's down to my left. I can't see whether he scored or not. But I see fan reaction, but the thing that I rely on, and Ray Scott taught me this lesson. Look at the official.
Okay.
The official will tell you. And I believe it was Boris Cheek who was right on the boundary in the end zone looking right at his feet. And he caught the ball, and I see Cheek's hands get up to his waist. I called touchdown. I kind of lucked into that one. And, that was my favorite moment.
So you knew when you were covering Dorsett that he'd have a great pro career. You felt that he was going to be unbelievable.
I remember getting into an argument over a cup of coffee and a piece of pie one night with this patron who said, he's going to have to play defense. He's too small to be a running back. I said, when's the last time you saw somebody get a square shot at him and really, you know, take him out? And he did the same things in the pros. Unfortunately, you know, it's a little bit like Muhammad Ali. You didn't think that people did a lot of damage, but, you know, Tony's struggling now with the, you know, concussion syndrome, and that's too bad. Yeah, I'm glad the NFL has taken a real hard look at mm-hmm. how they protect those guys now, and it's a much better thing. I really think, in my opinion, that it's the practice concussions that are damaging.
Yeah.
And they're the ones that don't go as noticed.
Right.
Yeah.
And so maybe they have to change the practice helmet. You mm-hmm. know, soft on the outside, hard on the inside.
Yeah.
We'll see what happens.
Dan Marino, you got to cover Dan. Dan's ready for the draft. Everybody, I remember it clear as day, everybody passes on him except for the Dolphins and Don Shula being a great judgment of talent. Rumors were coming out he had a drug problem. You were there. Were those rumors obviously false, and what was going on?
Yeah, I was there, and I knew something his parents didn't know at the time. And when Pitt got wind of it, they made him test every week for that season, and he never flunked a test. I think where they started was between his freshman and sophomore, or sophomore and junior, I can't remember which, he got involved with some guys that he probably shouldn't have been around. And I think that's where the rumors started. Naturally, it spread like wildfire in the National Football League. I was in his house, draft day, and he didn't get upset, visibly upset, until Ken O'Brien was drafted.
Yeah, by the Jets, I know.
Yeah.
Well, I know.
As a longtime Jet fan.
As a longtime Jacket, so we could have Marino end up with Ken O'Brien.
Exactly.
Yeah.
The phone rang, and Danny had been upstairs because he was visibly upset. And his mom said, Danny, Coach Shula's on the line. And I said, ooh, this could be good. And his dad looked at me and said, this might be the best thing that could happen to my son. I think had the Steelers drafted him, and we didn't know Bradshaw's arm was going to go bad.
Right.
It would have been tough.
Is that why, though? Because Bradshaw wasn't hurt yet?
Yeah, I think Chuck Knoll called him in and watched him, and I think he threw to either Swan or Stallworth and another Steelers receiver. He said, we love you. He said, but for you and for us, it's probably better that you play for another team, which I think was very wise.
Yeah.
No, if I'd have known Bradshaw's arm was going to go bad, you know, I'd have thought otherwise. But, you know, he became Mr. Miami, Mr. Dolphin. And I like what Wayne, the former owner.
Herzinger or something like that?
No, yeah,
Huizenga.
Wayne Huizenga took him out on the golf course because he was talking to the Minnesota Vikings about one more year. And he said, Danny, for the Dolphins and for the city of Miami and for your sake, it's better that you stay a Dolphin. And he talked him into retiring. And he's now a member of the Dolphin staff, and I think it's great.
Oh, yeah.
And, I mean, he set the world on fire right away.
Well,
I mean, 1984, that was...
He's a very good bad weather quarterback. And let's face it, coming down the stretch in December,
yep.
unless you're in a dome somewhere, yeah. you're going to have to be a good bad weather quarterback. Yep. And he was, even in Miami. They have monsoons, and he could still throw the ball. I think he's the best quarterback ever. There's an argument along those lines. People say, well, Joe Montana won more. Yeah, I said Dan didn't win Super Bowls because he yep. didn't have a great running back for most of
yep.
his career.
Right.
And didn't have a great defense
exactly.
for most of his
yep.
career.
Exactly. Yep. Foge Fazio was a coach at the Panthers, I think, part of Dan's career. What kind of guy was Foge Fazio?
Great guy. Knows defense, knows the game of football, was a good recruiter. I just think he was one of those people that couldn't translate his knowledge and skills into being a head coach. Personally, I think he was too nice a guy to be a, you know, because I think most head coaches sooner or later have to be able to lower the boom. Mm-hmm. And you just take a guy like Chuck Knoll, he could stare a hole through you. You know, and Mike Tomlin, he seems to be having fun with the players, but they know don't cross the line. And Bill Cowher was the same way. Bill would stiff arm you. I mean, it's interesting to see just how the Steelers coaches almost all have the same pattern.
Well,
but again, the players know who the boss is, and that has to be the case.
You know, you and I talked a little bit before the show aired, and I had this question down since '69, three coaches for the Steelers. You talk about consistency, and the players know who's in charge. Similarities and differences between Knoll, Cowher, and Tomlin.
Knoll was. Let me put it this way. If you would talk wine, aviation, cooking, photography, he could be expansive. The minute you brought up football, zip. Because I think Chuck knew that you couldn't teach him anything about this, the game of football. And so that's why he was built that way. Cowher was, like I say, he'd stiff arm you. He kept you out here. But I got along with him very well. I have to do the pregame show
right.
with the coaches, and I think I remember one time when I asked one too many questions about a bad loss. He said, "Can we start this all over again?" Okay, coach, fine. And Tomlin will go with the flow. I mean, he'll say something, and then if you go to break, he'll say, "Did we have to ask that last question?" You know, but leave it in there because he answered it well. You know, so they all have their differences, but. I think the similarity is that they know how to teach football and know how to teach people to win.
Was Cowher getting out because we didn't know at the time his wife was ill?
No, that was very sudden.
Okay.
I don't think that had anything to do with his decision. I think Bill wanted more power.
Okay.
And I think the Rooneys, I think, saw the danger in that. And you can see the examples around the league
sure.
where
yeah.
the head coach has all the power.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's not a good thing
yeah,
for
right.
the franchise. So, and I think, you know, let's face it, he was at the right place for many years, mm-hmm. and maybe one more year wouldn't have worked. And I think he felt that. You know, I've been here long enough. Maybe it's time to do something else. Now he loves coaching two teams, and he doesn't have to live with the results. And he can play golf. He can play golf three times a week.
Yeah.
He could never do that as a coach.
He's got a great job. In fact, I was me and my friends were. Texting, we were hoping the Jets were going to get him out of broadcasting and for their coach. And some people still think that the Giants might go after him when Cochran retires.
Well, he's got a New York draw now. He has an apartment there. I think his new significant other is from there. She's
right.
a successful
right.
Entertainer. And so, yeah, I, of all places, I think that's the one that could draw.
Now, he got involved in broadcasting. Being around as much as you have, different venues, WTAE, the Pitt, the Steelers. You've worked with a lot of people. We talked about Dick Grote, a little bit about Johnny Sauer. Two people who maybe some viewers don't know that you really were instrumental in really launching them, Mark May and Merrill Hodge. When they came on board with you, did you think that they had it in them? And how's it feel to see them now making two of the bigger guys on the big network?
I really did. When Mark worked with me, Myron's wife got sick, and he had to miss a game in Seattle. So Mark May came out to Seattle and did a superb job doing a Steelers game, and I said, this guy, he's got big plans. And the same way with Merle. We just kind of knew that Merle would fit into a thing that is, you know, like it's his power zone. ESPN with Jaws doing that coaching film. Yeah. And he's perfect. He's perfect for that. And you forgot Mike Gottfried.
Mike, yes. That's right.
He and I did a spring game together. And I launched Mike Gottfried's career. So it's been fun.
What about, let's talk about the famous, obviously, color man for the Steelers for many years, Myron Cope. What was it like working for him? Because he was like big in our life, correct?
He was. A dream. He'd bring a stack of index cards of preparation to the booth, about that thick. He'd go through maybe half of them. And I remember saying one day, Myron, I said, you only went through half of your preparation here. He said, Billy, he said, if the game becomes a stinker and a clunker, as he called it, he said, I still have to be entertaining. I still have to try to keep listeners, even though the score may be 41 to nothing. And so, you know, he was ready in case he had to do that fourth quarter Myron Cope dance that only he could do. I miss him every day. We were pals. I've had him to this place. Mm-hmm. I've had him out on the boat. And one of my favorite nights was an August night. The big harvest moon is just over the horizon. And he's silhouetted against the moon, directing the Count Basie Orchestra. And I had the speakers on the boat all the way up. I didn't have a camera. And I could, you know, kick myself in the head today for not having been able to preserve that moment. He's just a great guy and a great broadcaster. And the one thing I remember, you know, he's off the wall. But if you would come off the wall with something, he'd take it and run with it. Yeah. You know, he wouldn't look at you and say, hey, I'm the top banana here.
Right.
Because if you had something off the wall, he loved that too. So
it wasn't about him then. He just had a good time. And
And he connected with the fans.
And he came up with the terrible towel, is that correct?
He did. The boss, the radio boss said, Myron, we have to come up with a gimmick. He goes, I'm not a gimmick guy. And the boss said, your contract is up in January. He says, I'm all ears. And they had to come up with something that fans would already have. And I think it was Myron's idea. Well, everybody has a towel. How about a black or a gold towel? And that's really how that, and what put it over the top, because then they, you know, devised it and designed it and printed a whole bunch and brought them and gave them to fans at the stadium. But what made it go was that coming out of the tunnel, Lynn Swann waved the first terrible towel. The fans caught on, and it's been great ever since. It's raised over $3.5 million for the Allegheny Valley School, which is, you know, the cause is autism.
Yeah.
And his son is still there. And, you know, he signed the towel over to them. All the proceeds go to the school. And it's been phenomenal. And, you know, when you see other teams give away towels for promotions and wave them,
it's not the
as Tunch says, no. Steeler fans pay $10 for that towel.
That's right. Jerome Bettis, who just got inducted into the Hall of Fame recently, the bus. What kind of person is he?
Oh, just delightful. I remember...
And how did the Steelers get that trade with the Rams? I mean, what
would
the Rams
think? Coach Brooks didn't think that the bus fit his style of offense. Thank you, Coach Brooks. Jerome Bettis was a draft day pickup in 1996.
I remember that.
And he might be the Steelers, in the top three all-time number one picks. He wasn't really their pick.
Right.
That was a great trade because he fit the Steelers to a T. Personality-wise, style-wise, you know, you think of the Steelers, you think of power running game, and he did it as well as anybody, and he had good speed to go along with it. As a person, I had a ball in my basement that I forgot to get autographed, and I had promised to a dear friend that I would have him do it. The Steelers don't like when media people approach the players directly for things like that.
Okay.
You got to go through the system. Mm-hmm. So I had the ball in my bag. It was the last game of the season against the Bears, and you know that run with Brian Urlacher and so forth in the snow flurries. After the game, I'm in the locker room and I'm saying, here, Bus, can you sign this? He went like this. He pushed me aside and said, we're family here. And he took that pen and he signed it. He didn't care who was looking. And that's the kind of a guy Jerome is. Hall of Fame, as Mike Tomlin put it, yes, he is gold jacket worthy.
And it's crazy, they got that trade. That was right after they were in the Super Bowl. You know, they were a good team at that time, and they were able to get him and really lift it up.
Don't remind me of that Super Bowl.
I was just going to ask, you know, that
they had the Cowboys beat.
Yep,
the Cowboys,
they
had the look on their faces like, we want to get on a bus and go home. And then, you know, Neil O'Donnell decided that throwing the ball to the other team seemed like a good idea.
And look where he ended up.
Yeah, he's doing what we do.
No, but I mean,
stealing money.
But I mean, but Neil got the big contract from my team, the Jets, and
oh yeah,
and I was like, oh god.
Now, what was
You know, that's another Steelers secret, in my opinion. They've handled free agency as well as any team.
Yeah. Yeah, and how did they do that? How did they let players go? I think when they know it's just about done.
Mm-hmm.
Or if the player wants a lot of money, they'll say, see ya.
Right, and I think that's the Rooney consistency. Don't overspend. And you can look at their history, they haven't done it. And in the free agent period, they're not going to make any big splash mm-hmm. signings because they don't feel that that's going to put them over the top. The guys who are there are the guys who are going to get you to the Super Bowl. Yeah, you need somebody to fill in here, fill in there. Sure, they'll sign free agents. Mike Mitchell,
right.
You know, mm-hmm. Because Mr. Clark was on his way to broadcasting, stealing money legally. And, you know, Troy Polamalu, now Shamarco Thomas, has to jump in there. But Mike Mitchell came in as a free agent, and they needed D'Angelo Williams because they knew that Le'Veon Bell would be missing a couple of games. So, you know, I just think they do things right. And not spending too much money, and also, you know, knowing when it's time.
I think, too, as far as coaches, they're not the highest paid coaches in the league either. Compared to other city assistants as well, compared to other teams?
Well, those coaches are learning. And if they learn to be head coaches somewhere else, okay, the tree gets bigger.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, I think you're right. I think they are very wise with their money. And you had mentioned, and this sounds like I'm tooting my own horn, but three coaches since 1969. How about three broadcasters since 1938? Joe Tucker, Jack Fleming, and yours truly.
Let me ask you this, then. Did the Steelers hire their broadcaster, or did they let the radio people hire him and they okay him? How's that work?
No. Mr. Rooney.
Is that right?
Mr.
So
Rooney.
He brought you on, right?
Here's the story. I didn't go after the job.
Mm-hmm.
Jack Fleming was a friend of mine.
Right.
And I had a full plate. I had television. I had Pitt basketball and football. And one day, I get a call from a staffer who said, Mr. Rooney keeps asking for your tape. I said, what tape? I didn't submit a tape. But he was using my tape to compare it to other broadcasters who were applying for the job. And the more he listened to my tape, the more he liked it. And then one day I got the call from the boss who said, good news and bad news. What's the good news? He said, well, you're going to be the voice of the Pittsburgh Steelers. I said, what's the bad news?
Yeah.
You're going to take one heck of a pay cut. Television money to radio,
sure.
But hey, it's made me the happiest guy in the world. Full-time play-by-play guy, I pinch myself.
Yeah,
you have a dream job, gosh.
And then, you know, you're saying just a couple years into it, they get the first Super Bowl. Didn't end exactly the way we wanted to. Now, 10 years later, Super Bowl XL, the big one in Detroit. How can you compare the two, you know, maybe, I guess, professionally as well, and also for the fans? You know, you go into the first Super Bowl just a couple years into the job, kind of see what it's like, then the big one.
Super Bowl is all about venue. And Sun Devil Stadium is way different than Ford Field.
Mm-hmm.
Way different than Raymond James Stadium. And certainly way different than Jerry World. But these are the four that I've been privileged to do. And I think the venue is what sticks in your mind more than anything. And obviously, the games.
Mm-hmm.
I'm 2-2 in Super Bowl. Compared to Myron, that's not even close. He's 4-1, and Jack Fleming's 4-0. So I've got some work to do.
You know, I'd be remiss if I didn't tell the viewers of this show and congratulate you. A while back, you won the Chris Schenkel Award, and I got to listen to Chris Schenkel a lot, being from New York. What was it like winning his award? He was one of the best broadcasters in history, I think.
I was humbled because I got to know him at the Larry Holmes-Ronaldo Snipes fight in Pittsburgh in 1981. And you remember at the end of the fight, melee in the ring, mm-hmm. and the scissors that they were trying to use to cut the tape off Snipes' arm got into his arm, and he was cut, and he had to go to then the Central Medical Pavilion, which was right across the street. So my station dispatched me to hang outside the waiting room. Well, ABC dispatched Chris Schenkel.
Wow.
And so for maybe 15 minutes, I got to talk to the legend. And he was every bit as nice a guy as he was a great professional.
So it was very, you know, well-deserved on your part winning that. And then, I don't know, not recently, but a while back, Pitt honored you with your own day. What did that mean to you, Bill Hillgrove? That'd be unbelievable, Bill.
Well, I want to thank the people who, you know, got behind that movement. They obviously had to get to city council and also to the county.
Yeah.
And the two of them got together and said, we're going to have this day. What really was satisfying to me was a lot of my hometown guys from Garfield showed up in strength to support that. We had a mass at St. Lawrence O'Toole, jump in the limo, go down to city county building and do that thing down there. And then University of Pittsburgh hosted a reception at the Peterson Event Center that I will always, always remember. Bill Hillgrove Day. I know my grandsons were impressed.
And that's an honor when you get something like that. You've been broadcasting a long time. Some of the unusual things that have happened to you guys when you're doing a game that you laugh at after.
Well, Myron at Three River Stadium used to jump up, and unfortunately the monitor was above his head. So he banged that thing a couple of times, or it banged him. And they put rubber padding on it, and he calls attention to it. He walks in the booth, and he says, oh, I got to talk about this. I got rubber padding under there. I need to protect my noggin. And he did on the air. And we started laughing about that and maybe some other goofy thing. And I said, you know, Myron, maybe they ought to pad the whole booth. You know, he didn't like that snide remark about him being crazy. But, you know, just things like that. I told you the Johnny Sauer story with the tears coming down. You know, there have been some, but I probably have to sit and give that thought and maybe think about writing a book.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I hesitate because they want you to, you know, do the Jim Bouton thing and spill the beans on people, and I won't do that.
No.
But certainly I think I've been around enough Pitt and Steeler lore that I could probably make something interesting, I hope. But while I'm doing it, I don't have the time.
That's right.
So that's something you do when you retire.
When you retire.
And guess what? The guy upstairs is going to decide when I retire.
Nice. If you had it. I know you've interviewed a lot of different athletes around the area, but if you had to interview one athlete you haven't had a chance to yet, who would that be and why?
If I hadn't had a chance to yet?
Yeah, if you haven't had a chance to interview one athlete in any sport, who would it be that you'd really like to interview you haven't had a chance to yet?
Guys, let me think about that, because I've been around some greats. Terry Bradshaw was my favorite. He was
fun. Why?
He was just fun, and he was a quarterback.
And he was dumb as a fox, correct? But he had that reputation he wasn't smart, correct?
That's so bent out of shape, it's not even funny. You know, the guy, he cared about quarterbacks, he always did. How's Danny doing? How's he doing? You know, that senior year, he'd call me, and then he finally fessed up. He said, people don't realize how tough it is to play this position. He said, and this is when you could do it, I'll call a screen pass if I can't hit the broadside of a barn just to get a completion.
Right.
He said, people don't understand how tough this job is. Yeah. For that, I've always admired his honesty. Who would I want to interview that I never had the chance to interview? Gosh, that's a tough one. You know, Jim Brown.
Okay.
I always thought he's the best back I ever saw. And, you know, I never had the chance to interview him. Myron did a book with him, but it didn't sell because Jim wouldn't promote it. And Myron never forgave him for it.
Mm-hmm.
But I'd like to talk to Jim Brown and pick his brain about some things, because you know, he was magnificent. Power, speed, competitive desire. He'd act like he was all banged up, dragged himself back to the huddle, and bang, the next play.
Gained 12 more yards.
Oh my, he was absolutely something to watch.
Was Chuck Knoll as tough on Terry Bradshaw as people said he was?
I don't think he was, but you know, I don't think you know, Chuck wasn't the kind of a guy that would that you'd want to have a beer with. And I'm sure Terry felt that way. Terry is more of an outgoing social butterfly. And I think, you know, they were just different people. And I think people misunderstood that difference to be something of a love-hate relationship, and I don't think it was that at all. And I'm glad to see that Terry finally made an effort to re-embrace the city of Pittsburgh.
Mm-hmm.
Let's face it, he had a couple of bitter divorces in Pittsburgh. He first learned of his, you know, affliction with depression in Pittsburgh. And so even though the Super Bowls were there, his memories of Pittsburgh were bittersweet. And I think that was as much a part of his problem as anything. But I think the other stuff was beat out of shape.
It's nice when they brought him back, and I think his daughter sang the national anthem one time also, if I'm not mistaken, which was a nice tribute to him and his daughter. You've seen a lot of great Steelers. No matter what team it is, Bill, I think you'd agree with this. If you don't have the quarterback, you're not going to win. Is that correct?
Exactly. You're not going to win the big one. You can, you know, win, but you're not going to be in that that final group of six teams that really have a legitimate shot at it, unless you have a franchise quarterback.
So when Steelers drafted Ben, do you think that was a gamble, or did you know that, hey, they're going to hit on something here?
I kind of figured at the beginning, and I remember everybody talked Philip Rivers.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And mm-hmm. everybody, well, they knew that they had no chance at, you know,
Manning.
The Manning kid. But I thought at the time, I said, I think he might be the best of the three. And what has happened since, I think it has proven it.
Yep.
You know, he was the best of the three, and I think he was the guy they wanted all the time. And I'm not going to accuse Kevin Colbert of issuing smoke screens through the media, but I think that's what he did. I think the Steelers gave you the impression that they liked Philip Rivers. And I'd seen him play at NC State. I didn't think he was that special.
Right.
But I didn't see Ben at Miami of Ohio, but he's pretty special.
And he takes hits. I mean, he's tough. He shakes off people. He runs. I mean, he's a good leader, isn't he?
He's a leader because he was a point guard, a shortstop, and a quarterback.
Okay.
Aren't those the three positions that, A, you must have innate leadership skills, and B, you can't teach those positions.
Yep.
You can't become a quarterback. Ask Tom Matty.
Yeah, huh? That's right.
That's you and I remember.
Oh, yeah.
You can't become a shortstop. Uh-huh. You can maybe play it for a few days, and you can't become a point guard because those innate skills have to be there, and many of them are leadership skills.
We talked a little bit before about venues with the Super Bowls. What's your favorite place to broadcast, and what's maybe, I don't know, least favorite or the toughest place to call a game?
Wow. That's a toughie. I hate Jerry World. I have to use the Jumbotron.
Wow.
And I'm saying, hopefully, I'm not looking at the senders behind and a large football. You know, I want to see, because I had to use it to see what was happening. They're like ants. Mm. And I've done a Super Bowl there, and I think one other regular season game. I don't like that place. My favorites, Cleveland Stadium is a very good view. Baltimore Stadium, very good view. Cincinnati, the division really has, you know, good facilities for visiting broadcasters.
Panthers and the Steelers?
Yep, same booth. And I know I have to do the whole game looking to my left, but I've adjusted to it, and they give me a monitor with real-time action, so when the play gets down that other end and I have trouble seeing which ant has the football, I've got the monitor in front of me, and that helps. I can't see the other upright, so I'm on the end line.
Okay.
But there are guys worse than me. The national radio sometimes is next door, and then the visitors are beyond that. So, but it's tough. But I understand. You know, you have to have your stadium make money, and that's how you afford salaries. You know,
if Monday night football or Sunday night football is coming in, do they get a nice place then?
Oh yes, they get their midfield. Yes. Well, the TV networks can demand it.
Yeah.
Let's face it, it's a TV sport. Mm-hmm. And nothing's going to change that.
You know, it's interesting about that. Jim and I were talking on the way down. I know many people in this area, Bill, just to let you know, when the Steelers are on TV, they will turn their sound down and listen to you.
We appreciate that. And I go back to Myron's days. They did a study. The average NFL fan, 38% do that around the country. In Pittsburgh at the time when Myron was broadcasting, it was 51%. Mm-hmm. So more people did that than didn't, which I think was a tribute to him. But, you know, we give you the Steelers' perspective, and I feel a little sorry for those guys that have to be neutral, because there is no such thing as neutral.
No.
You love one team and you hate the other. I mean, it's the nature of competitive sports, and to be neutral, and what you hear the national guys do, and I think it can be off-putting for, you know, passionate fans. If something is said good about the Steelers, they feel immediately compelled to say something nice about the other team. And that waffling back and forth, I think, drives some fans crazy. We just give you the Steelers' perspective, and if they're doing well, we're happy. And if they're stinking the joint out, we tell you that too.
I saw something funny in Sports Illustrated about that. It was like a survey of the worst things in the NFL, worst announcer, the national guy calling your team's game. So that was
what?
It sounds to fans, you know, they infer that they're being rooted against.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And in some cases, I think it's true. I don't think Chris Collinsworth likes the Steelers.
No.
Bob Trumpy didn't like them. And then the more I think about that, well, the Steelers used to beat up on them.
Exactly.
So,
Bungles.
When you're doing a game, last game of the year, and doesn't mean anything for the Steelers, tough game to do. It's not going to put them in the playoffs or help them in any way.
No, because what I have to do is my nuts and bolts. I have to tell you where the ball is, who has it, what the score is, how much time is left. what down it is. You know, I still have to do, it's tougher on the color man if it's the last game of the year, it doesn't mean anything, or even worse, non-competitive.
Right.
And I felt so bad for Bill Osborne when Pitt played Ohio State during that 72-0 mm-hmm. walloping way back when. I could still tell you how much time was left, where the ball was, what the score was, and he had to try to make sense of that, and that's impossible.
Good move for Pitt going to the ACC,
yes,
do you think?
I think it is. It geographically makes sense. It's a more solid football setting for them. And let's face it, they were in a position like musical chairs. When the music stops, you better find a place to sit down.
Right.
And they had a place to sit down, and so did Syracuse, and I think that was good. Some other schools weren't that lucky. And
basketball-wise, it's a great conference.
Oh, it is. And Pitt's program will add to that, mm-hmm. and Syracuse certainly will add to that. The Big East was the best basketball conference ever, but guess what? Now that those two schools are in the ACC, mm-hmm. that's the best basketball conference going right now.
What do you think about the rivalries? I know a lot of people talk about the Penn State football rivalry, the backyard brawl. I know that's one thing moving
coming back a little bit, right? Are they going to play again?
Yeah, Pitt and Penn State have renewed, I think, for 4 years, but they're talking about a longer-term arrangement. It's just tougher because the conference comes first.
Yeah. Right. Big
back in
ACC.
The days when they were independents, you could always make it the last game of the year, and the bragging rights until next season and all of that stuff that goes with it. And I'm glad it's back. Pitt, West Virginia, I think that's probably a less makeable putt in terms of scheduling. And so I think West Virginia would love to do it. But if Pitt gets Penn State back on the schedule, that game was always more important to the Panthers than was the West Virginia game.
Right.
And conversely, West Virginia's was they hate Pitt.
Yep.
You know, and it's just the situation. I'd love to be able to see them play both, but I'm sure Coach Narduzzi would kick me under the table and say I play a tough enough non-conference schedule.
Let's talk about Pitt football one more time for a second here, Bill, because the last few years has been a revolving door of head coaches coming here, and some people think they're using Pitt as a stepping stone. Do you think that's going to stop down the road and Pitt's going to be able to hold on to a coach for 10 years or something?
I like the way Narduzzi handled it at his introductory news conference where a reporter said, well, Paul Christ went back home. Is there any chance that you're going to do that?
Good question. Yeah.
And he said, well, I am home. I'm a Youngstown kid.
Oh, wow.
And I think that answers it pretty well. Yeah. I think, you know, he's probably where he wants to be for a long time. He's got a youngster in high school. So, you know, setting the roots, well, heck, he was 9 years at Michigan State.
Yes.
Before that with D'Antonio at Cincinnati.
Right.
So he hasn't had to make that many stops. So I think it's important for him to establish the hometown roots, and I hope he stays, and I think he will.
Can Pitt be a national contender someday?
Yes. Just got to win. Mm-hmm. And that's something that the coaches haven't done consistently.
Do you like the playoff format for college football today?
It's not perfect, but I think it works. And where do you draw the line? Final four? Final eight? No matter where you draw the line, there's going to be gnashing of teeth. And last year, I think Ohio State did everybody a favor by mm-hmm. winning the thing, and the people in Texas had to zip it up because, you know, they were, why weren't we? You know, and you're always going to have the Boise States and people like that, but you know, hey, it's headed toward a super conference. I don't think we've had the last earthquake yet.
Wow. Do you love the NCAA to one and done basketball?
I don't have a problem with it. I really don't. Basketball is the nature of it. If you add three players, you can go from an 0-20 team to a champion. Football, you can't do that. You know, it's an apple against an orange. But yeah, the one and done doesn't bother.
And at Pitt, you know, Jamie Dixon, he doesn't go for those one and done guys, you know, so he builds the program, builds the team. And I think that's why, you know, a lot of people, why doesn't he have anyone in the NBA, et cetera, et cetera. But I think, you know, what he does, I like that model of play. You know, it's not like the Louisville or the Kentucky where you get a guy in there, they're out the next year. You know, I think Coach Dixon really gets it. And, you know, that's why I've always been a Pitt fan going back to the Paul Evans days. But I really like Jamie Dixon, and do you agree with that? You know, get the core 3 or 4 year guys.
Again, we go back to the word stability.
Yep.
And there's nothing like it because there's not enough of it in sports.
We're going to wrap this up, Bill, but before I do, I'd be remiss if I didn't say, tell us about how you got so interested in jazz. They know you did a little show, right?
It started in high school. A buddy of mine said, come on, we're going to Carnegie Hall. I said, who are we going to hear? He said, the four freshmen. And I was like bowled over. And then a couple weeks later, he said, we're going back. Who's this? Dave Brubeck and Maynard Ferguson. And then all of a sudden, here I am in high school. Mm-hmm. And then when I get to college, my second year, I work for a good music station, WKJF. I kind of missed the rock and roll period. I didn't miss it completely.
Right.
I was a disc jockey at Central's right. Dances. I played jailhouse rock. But, you know, I had just developed that taste for it. And thank God I did, because I enjoy it to this day. Yeah. And when we travel, Dick mm-hmm. Grote and I, we have been known to attend jazz clubs.
Right.
And I'll never forget the Rainbow Room. Woody Herman's band is up there. All of a sudden, I look. Here comes Jake Hanna, the drummer, and Woody Herman to our table. They want to talk baseball with Dick Grote, and naturally Dick wants to talk music.
Yeah.
And I remember Dick saying, Woody, he said, how long does it take you to put together a band that goes back out on the road? He says, Dick, about 20 minutes. These kids know my stuff better than I do.
Nice.
Yeah, it's been kind of a fun thing. We befriended Dave McKenna, great piano player, and he was a Boston Red Sox fan. And he wanted to talk baseball, and naturally we wanted to talk music.
Yeah.
So the two kind of fit together, I guess, because we work the same type schedules. You do a lot of night work.
A lot of night work.
I love that story real quick, where the young man from Long Island wanted Dick Grote to sign his bat, and he went back home, got the bat, came back to the club. You guys were still there, and he signed it.
We were in the same seats.
Yeah, that was awesome.
Same bar stools. We didn't move. And, it's fun, especially when you go to New York with Dick. You know, the Yankee fans almost do this,
yeah.
You know.
I bet. Well, Bill, thanks a million for coming on our
Thank
show.
Thank you, guys. I enjoyed it so much.
For our special guest, Bill Hillgrove, my partner, Jim Berger, this is Mike Fiorillo, Sports Close-Up on Armstrong. And what a great interview that was with Bill Hillgrove. And Jimmy, I know you being a Steeler fan, you had to be excited about that one.
Oh, yeah, really. I mean, I grew up listening to him. You know, I remember him. He was the main sports anchor on Channel 4 in Pittsburgh.
Then WTAE.
WTAE, yes. And then Pitt, of course. He did a lot of the Pitt games. My dad and I would always watch, listen, actually. And then he moved on to the Steelers. But so,
well, he still does Pitt football and basketball.
He still does. I mean, that's just the voice that I remember, you know, growing up. That was like one of the voices of my childhood.
And I know this happened a couple weeks ago, but what a tough injury for Pitt early on in the season, losing their best running back in Connor.
Yeah, I know. I may have jinxed them when we did our previous show a couple weeks ago. I said, you know, Pitt has the best running back, best wide receiver in the conference. Well, they're down one now, so that could be a big hit for them. You know, I just hate to see Pitt, you know, every year 5-6, 6-5, 7-6. You know, I thought that this could have been the year where they really pushed it ahead with Connor healthy and Boyd healthy, but they could have their hands full.
And I got to say, Jeff and Kevin are in the back there filming for us, but I got to say, sitting next to Jim here, I feel like I'm a little munchkin here. My Jim just dwarfs me, man. You're a big guy.
Well, Jeff said we could have gotten the phone books for you. So.
I'll tell you. All right, you wanted to talk about fantasy football.
Well, I just said, you know, football season's in full swing right now, and, you know, fantasy football is a booming business right now, especially those one-day draft leagues. I stay away from those. Well,
Do you know what those are about? I mean, do you go in and do you pay your own money to draft a team? How's that work?
Essentially, well, I know with baseball, basketball, sports like that, you get one. You can make a new team every day. So you
right.
can put in, I don't know, $25, $50.
How much is it a player? Does it depend?
I think it depends, yeah. You can, almost like gambling in Vegas. You know,
okay.
You put $5 down, you put $100 down. So
I'm surprised those are legal in every state.
And now they're very, you know, they're very much in the limelight. You know, ESPN's pushing them. You know, they're in every magazine. ESPN now on SportsCenter has a segment that they almost analyze it just for the DraftKings and those one-day draft league purposes. So,
and people can win a lot of money. I see that commercial where those guys won $100 million, right? $1 million.
$1 million.
Yeah.
$100 million. That'd be something.
Now it's up to $2 million, I think.
But
for this year.
Yeah, but you know, I do the typical fantasy league, entertainment purposes only. But we
Had you draft? Who did you draft for your quarterback?
I have Matt Ryan. It was between him. I took him a little later. I went with wide receivers and running backs to start. It was between Ryan and Romo. I like, you know, Ryan, I think, is a little more proven. Romo could be a wild card. We have Matt Forte, Demaryius Thomas, Andre Johnson, Larry Fitzgerald, Justin Forsett, Heath Miller, and the Denver Broncos defense.
So you're not really going to win this league this year.
You never know. You never know. The Yahoo draft boards gave me a B-plus for my draft and said it B-plus. Was a safe bet.
Now, who's in your draft league? A bunch of guys at the school? Or?
No, it's actually, well, I'm also in one at school with a bunch of the coaches. That team, I didn't do very well at all in the draft. We're not going to talk about that one. But the one that I drafted the other night, it was a bunch of the second one I drafted in, it was a bunch of friends of mine that I played baseball with, some guys I knew from college and
so
everything.
So you guys do it using a computer, obviously.
Yeah, we did. We usually, you know, back when I used to live down by Pittsburgh, mm-hmm. would actually have the live draft and all 14 people would be there. That was kind of fun. But we knocked the online draft out in like an hour and 15 minutes, so it wasn't bad. But.
You know, being our show, it would take me a little bit early, but I know coming up, and I wanted to get this out there, sometime in October, Armstrong will be broadcasting live the MASH Cash football game, and that'll be a great game to broadcast. So you people have the opportunity, if you can't get to Bender Field in Meadville that night, you'll have an opportunity to watch it live. In fact, Jeff was telling me PCN's coming in. They're going to broadcast that game live throughout the whole state.
That's great. That's big.
So that's something for people to be excited about also. So hopefully by the time that game comes about, both teams are playing well and doing well, and the game will really mean something.
They definitely, I mean, they're off to a great start, both of them.
Well, last year, Cash just manhandled. Yeah. In fact, Cash has won every meeting with Meadville so far. So, you know, I don't call it a rivalry until Meadville wins a game.
Yeah.
You know, if you're getting dominated by a school, to me, it's not a rivalry.
No, Cash has been rolling everyone, though. You know,
great program there with Pat Gould.
That really is.
Outstanding quarterback. You and I talked about him off camera. Hunter Merritt in this area. I think he's the best all-purpose quarterback around.
He can run. He can throw. Plays a little bit of defense. So Cash has something really special in him. You know, it's the talk about the once-in-a-generation player or once-in-a-decade player. That could be one of those cases.
And as we said, you know, football's underway, baseball playoffs are underway, and my sleeper team, that might be out already the time this airs, I don't think so, but my sleeper team going into playoffs is going to be the Cubbies.
Yeah, they're good. You know, you just wonder, I'm a big Pirates fan, and I know that's why you're saying that, you're trying
no,
to...
No, 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 I like the New York teams. I think the Mets have the best young pitching in baseball going down the road, but I think the Cubs right now... Boy, Madness turned that whole franchise around, hasn't he?
He really has. You know, they were sad sack the last few years. But the thing I'd worry about with the Cubs, there are a lot of young guys. You know, that could be in their favor. You know, they're too dumb to even be nervous, or they could be overwhelmed by the bright light. So I think it could go either way, but they're definitely, especially the second half of the season, they've been incredible. You know, I've been worried more about them as a Pirates fan than I have about the Cardinals. So.
And to me, the Pirates have the key factor, and they have one of the best players in the game in McCutchen.
They do. Even their whole outfield now. Polanco is heating up. Marte, I think, is one of the most underrated players in baseball as well. You know, now that you have Ramirez playing at first base a little bit, you have Jung Ho at third, I think that infield's, you know, solid across. You know, I think it's a pretty good 1-9 lineup myself. But, again, I might be biased.
And, you know, too, for the Pirate fans, they got to be happy with, because I know they lost Russell Martin. They were, like, upset that he left, but... They picked up Francis Cervelli from the Yankees, and he's had a career year this year, and he's a tough guy.
Yeah, I mean, he gets the foul tips off the knees. He gets banged in the bare hand all the time, but he never comes out and hitting over 300. I mean, I think that, you know, he doesn't have the power that Martin has, but Martin barely would hit over 260. So I think it was a pretty fair swap right there. It wasn't exactly a trade, but I think it was a very good acquisition, low key.
It was, and the Yankees got Wilson from the Pirates, and he's pitched well for the Yankees, so that was a good trade for both teams there.
Yeah, I liked Wilson when he was coming up. You know, lefty that throws hard, but, you know, Pirates bullpen, I think they're doing pretty well without him. So,
in our next show, we have a local celebrity, a very influential person in the area. He's given money to many causes, and we're excited that we'll be having Jim Duratz on our next show. And I know, Jim, you'll be meeting him for the first time, I think, but just a great man in this community and a big, big supporter of Pitt sports. So we'll be talking to him about the Pitt Panthers and their sporting teams, and hopefully you'll watch. So
as long as I don't scare him away.
I don't think
you will. First time they see me in studio here. So,
so for Jim Berger, this is Mike Fiorella. You've been watching Sports Close-Up on Armstrong.